Our learnings over the past 2 years, where we've deployed Enterprise 802.11n, are several. And we'll sort of classify them under three categories. One is what we see in terms of core network, second, what we see in terms of operations, and third, what we see in terms of applications. What I'm going to do is essentially just read out each of these and make comments only as necessary. First one I already talked about, significantly higher client complexity. There's about 5,000 combinations to test. And therefore, getting the combinations right or tuning the client right itself is a big challenge, which really leads us to our original concept of saying, don't worry about client tuning, take control back into the network. Second, RF is significantly more complex than ABG. It's better, but much more spiky and erratic, which means you cannot predict or design away co-channel interference. Power control is less effective in mitigating co-channel interference. Why is that? Because of MIMO, there is no tight correlation in terms of feet per dB. So just because you reduce your power by 2 dB doesn't mean that your signal does not go 10 more feet, right? So reducing power and reducing coverage are not correlated, but not tightly correlated, very difficult to predict, again, because it's spiky and erratic. What are you going to correlate? You can't leave the roaming decision to a client when things are so erratic and unpredictable, right? Because the client might see a good thing one instant, you just turn a little bit, it might see a bad thing. So the network, based on global knowledge and long-term knowledge, needs to decide who goes where. You can't let the client make its own unilateral decision. Even if it makes the right one for itself, it could be the wrong one for the network. And of course, given all of these different tuning parameters, it's highly possible that a client has suboptimal tuning. Now, the next thing that we learned, APs that are designed for looks might have very severe performance and robustness issues. There are APs that look very nice in the industry, no question about that. You put them on the wall, they look beautiful. However, if you open up the cover, you see that the antenna orientation is such that they're designed for polarity in one dimension, or at most two. And some of these APs actually use diplexers in their antennas, which just logically doesn't make sense, because the way you position or spread apart your antennas for 2.4 gigahertz would be different than 5. In healthcare, making DAS work requires special changes and optimization. And finally, as you have multiple antennas, their relative position makes a huge impact. Okay, so these are all some of the key things that we've learned in terms of the core network. In terms of operations, there are several key learnings, and I'll go through these. The first one is troubleshooting with 802.11n is a heck of a lot more complex. It's complex for actually a variety of reasons. First off, the protocol itself is inherently more complex, right? Just decoding the protocol, the number of different kinds of control messages and different state transitions one can make with 11n are significantly higher. On top of that, the network itself is a lot more erratic, as we've already talked about. So you somehow need a stable RF. And most importantly, it is really, really difficult to recreate problems precisely by repetition. If someone, you know, comes to a help desk and says, hey, I had a problem last Friday at, you know, 1 o'clock in a particular location, my phone call didn't work. You can't simply take your own, you as a help desk admin, can't simply go take your own laptop there, try to, you know, make another phone call on a Tuesday at 2 p.m. and try to recreate the problem. It may work, you could get lucky, but the chances are that it might not. The problem might not be easily repeatable because different devices have different behavior, and the same device might see very, very different behavior at different times, even assuming the ambient noise and channel characteristics have not changed. So this really points to something which is a key thing that we learned and implemented as a part of our network operation suite, which is you have to be able to record RF events and rewind and playback. You can't depend on recreating them on the fly by going at a later time and taking, you know, any device that you want. Okay, so these were some of the key issues that we looked at and saw, or key learnings for us in terms of building the base network and operating and managing them. The next set of learnings were really in terms of applications. The first one, since losses are more bursty, you need a change to the scheduling and contention algorithms compared to ABG. Simply porting your ABG mechanisms won't work. And in fact, we've seen how some of the other vendors have done that to great detriment in terms of level and performance, and we'll talk about that. Again, we've said the trade-off between efficiency and fairness are very different, and in fact, because of the bursty nature, as you have a large number of devices, and of course the number of devices increases over time, uplink can kill downlink even more. In a companion video, I talked about how uplink kills downlink performance. Now, combine that with the ability of uplink traffic to start bursting. Not only do uplink devices get more of the airtime, they start bursting more. So in fact, downlink can get completely starved. We also talked about the implication of rate adaptation algorithms. Picking the right rate at which to send is really important, because if you get it wrong, you could lose a whole burst, not just one frame, right? Again, we also talked about the implication of multicast. These optimization criteria have changed a lot, because with ABG, you had less capacity but less loss. So the focus was on optimizing capacity. You could go conservative in terms of the rate transmission. So what you'd want to do is make sure that the loss of the system inherently was minimized, and therefore the entire focus was trying to figure out what's the best rate at which to send your multicast so that you're able to pump it out as quickly as possible. With 11N, you have a lot more capacity but a lot more loss. So in fact, it makes sense to pull down the rate and minimize loss rather than try to up the rate and minimize time. It's a lot more sophisticated than that, but at least at the high level, the key point to recognize is multicast with 11N inherently could have issues. Also, when you do voice and video, again as a part of this bursting, turns out that voice and video streams could get out of sync very quickly. You need to do something very clever in order to figure out how the different streams that are a composite of an application need to be sent at the same time. Because the way you do bursting, automatically the tendency is to try to get these different streams that are going at different priority levels, voice and video, to get out of sync, because video might end up bursting more. And in fact, we see that with a lot of vendors that have not specifically targeted this, wherein at a high density, the video and voice get completely out of sync. Last two points. The first one is that client performance is at least as much a function of drivers and rate and aggregation settings as it is in terms of number of streams and antennas. It's very easy to get caught up in this 2x2, 3x3 number of streams, etc. It's a numbers game. But in fact, most of the time, your client performance is really a function of how the settings are done and whether the network has control or the client itself is making its own, somewhat arbitrary choices. And the last point, kind of making it all interesting and much more complex, is the fact that there are a lot more devices in the network. Therefore, device density has become a major issue. So these are some of the key things that have driven our network that we learned over the past 2.5 years or so of being in the enterprise game. And what it has allowed us to do is refine our core architecture in ways that allow us to leverage the network control, that allow us to leverage the complete absence of channel planning in our system, and allow us to leverage 802.11n and optimized algorithms in order to deliver for you the best performing 802.11n network. Thank you.